46 Leaders Speak program. Today we have lined up a discussion on a very interesting topic with the dawn of management and policy consulting in India. Those of you who have witnessed India's early economic liberalization and globalization in the 1980s and 90s will remember him well, and I'm sure the others have all heard of him. Dr. Athreya, it is a real pleasure to have you with us on the IIMA platform today, and many thanks for agreeing to do this session. You're a pioneer of management consulting business in India, and you're probably the only management guru to receive the Padma Bhushan from the Government of India. You were there to help Indian promoters and CEOs before McKinsey's and others arrived in India. In fact, you became synonymous with restructuring as Indian business houses rushed to capitalize on economic liberalization. Even before the opening up, you had been involved with the restructuring of some key public sector corporations. You also headed the Telecom Restructuring Committee in 1991, which paved the way for the telecom revolution in the country. Before venturing into consulting, you had taught at IIM Calcutta, the London Business School, and the Strathclyde Business School, Scotland. Thank you for joining us this evening and a very warm welcome to you. Mr. Singhania, always a pleasure to have you with us, and many thanks for agreeing to moderate this session. I know it's special for you since you know Dr. Athreya so well. A very warm welcome to you also. Ladies and gentlemen, China's rise as a military and economic superpower is casting a shadow on India. China's increasing economic and geopolitical aggression is making India uncomfortable about doing business with China, despite its enviable efficiency and costs in manufacturing. Also, the COVID crisis has revealed the vulnerability of China-centric supply chains. Moreover, China is trying to influence the terms of global trade and investment and also reshape the values and institutions in its own image. The growing centricity of China in the global economy and India's discomfort with Chinese hegemonic aspirations pose a serious challenge to Indian business. In this session, we look forward to hearing Dr. Athreya more on the China challenge to Indian management and identify ways to make Indian companies more capable and competitive. It is now my pleasure to invite Mr. Singhania to take over and conduct the discussion with Dr. Athreya. Over to you.
Thank you, Rekha. A very good evening to everybody. On this call, we have a very large number, as I can see, no doubt drawn by Dr. Athreya's presence. Before I start the formal part of the proceedings, let me say what a great privilege it is for me personally, as well as for IIMA, to have Dr. Athreya here with us. As you said, Rekha, India's foremost and perhaps most well-known management guru, author, educationist, policy maker, everything rolled into one. But most important, a human being from whom, at least every time I have interacted, I have come away richer with learnings. So it is really a special privilege for me to welcome Dr. Athreya this evening. Rekha, thanks for setting this up. And thank you to each one of you who is joining us this evening. You know, let me start, Dr. Athreya, by first felicitating you on your 80th birthday, which was barely a couple of months ago, 7th of May. And on behalf of IIMA, we wish you great health and an active life ahead, because this is what you have always stood for. And this is what you were explaining right now before we started the call. One of the secrets as to how you do this. You exercise twice a day. You keep a very disciplined life, which, by the way, I have seen personally from our interactions. Ladies and gentlemen, I have had the honor of knowing Dr. Athreya for more than 30 years now, which is the majority of my working life. And he was sort of the first management guru that I came across. And he has done a lot of work with us, and we have learned a lot from him. He has led some of our top management conferences, besides that in our group, and he has done a lot of things. Dr. Athreya, I was also very pleased that you were conferred the title of Dharma Pracharak by Sri Sri Jagatguru Shankaracharya of the Sharda Peetham on the occasion of your 80th birthday. One of the unique things I have found is that while all along over the decades, you have propagated Indian modern management thinking and keeping up with the changing times, you have rooted them very deeply with Indian values and our Indian ethos. That is the unique flavor you bring, and you bring it very seamlessly, which is fairly unique. So really, it is really fantastic to have you. Turning to the subject at hand, the emergence of China as an economic center of the world, combined with China's aggressive behavior, have created a dilemma for Indian business. By no means I wish to indulge in any kind of China bashing, quote unquote, but this is a real challenge. China is both a key resource for India's economy, as well as a latent threat to our security. India's pivot to Atmanirbhar Bharat is partly a response to the disruption of the China-centric supply chains because of COVID, the US-China technology tussle, as well as an outcome of the realization that India cannot have strategic autonomy without Indian businesses rivaling China's production, prices, and investment. Indian management, of which you are very familiar, also faces a dilemma in resetting its values and practices to adjust to the new economic compulsions and opportunities. Despite India's liberal traditions, there is a certain admiration of the ruthless efficiency of the Chinese way. China's apparent success in bouncing back very quickly post-COVID has also been noticed, and one wonders whether there are certain systemic reasons behind it. However, what is missed is the fact that China's rise is not because of a single party democracy, but because of its ideological flexibility. When Mao was destroying China, in a way, with the great, or at least destroying imperial China, I should say, with the Great Leap Forward and Cultural Revolution, his deputy, Deng Xiaoping, was telling China that to be rich was glorious, and it did not matter whether the cat was black or white, so long as it caught the mice. His even more important advice to China was to hide its strength and bide its time, which has now been cast aside by the new leadership. While the Chinese way is trying to replace the long-standing hegemony of the Western values, standards, and institutions, Indian management needs to find its own way of getting the best results in Indian conditions and within our culture. The key challenge for India's management thinkers and leaders is to ensure that the Indian way is competitive with the most efficient systems in the world and delivers results. Our management must avoid the temptation to go back to antiquity to find answers and answers to the present and future issues. We must build on the foundation of past wisdom, no doubt, by learning from our experience in the present and also learn from innovations of others. For example, the whole world learned just-in-time manufacturing and total quality management from the Japanese industry, which itself learned this from American companies. Indian management, therefore, can selectively take useful things from the Chinese management while building mostly Indian systems, standards, and practices. For example, Indian companies can learn something from Chinese industry's total flexibility They are willing and are able to meet customers' demand for almost any quality, any quantity, any price, and any delivery schedule. Our management must find a way to achieve similar capability without trying to match questionable labor practices. Indian management can perhaps use incentives for work and workers to drive competitiveness instead of obsessing with labor laws alone. Dr. Athreya, you have done a lot of work on comparative management practices, and you have been constantly updating yourself with contemporary practices across the globe. And we would therefore be very interested in understanding how you think Indian companies can compete with the Chinese instead of simply joining them. With these words, it is now once again my privilege, pleasure, and honor to ask you to deliver your remarks, and we look forward to a very enlightening conversation after this. Thank you, Dr. Athreya, and welcome.
Thanks very much. Thank you, Rekha, for your generous introduction. Thank you, Harsh, for your very touching remarks about our long relationship, and also your very perceptive opening remarks about Indian management, China, what we can learn, as well as where we should differ. And I think these are already a start of our debate. So may I now request for the PowerPoint, please? The IT team, we had gone through a dry run this morning at 11 o'clock. Right, thanks very much. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure for me to speak to you today, both as a fellow member of the All India Management Association, as well as a lifelong student of management, Indian and global. Next slide. So I'd like to compliment IMA for this idea of a leader speak session. And already 45 sessions are over, this is the 46th. So this is just to say my coordinates. The government of India gave me in 2014 the Padma Bhushan, mainly for my work in the my area of creating an Indian professional management movement. Next slide. So let's start with the map of the two countries. China is just to the north of us. Huge country, huge territory, almost sitting on top of us. Now, for a long time, many centuries, the Himalayas were our defense, but they are able to breach it easily. It's no longer a natural defense for us. Recently, the attack in Ladakh, Galwan, and even the protest against Dalai Lama birthday greetings 2 days ago. So they can get anywhere. So we have to defend ourselves both on land and on sea, on the military term, but that's not what I'm going to talk about today. I'm going to talk about particularly the challenge to Indian management. And I'm going to offer a very big, very enhanced, enriched role to Indian management than even comparative management practices, benchmarking, improving things here and there. I'm going to offer you a much bigger suggestion, role for your consideration. Next slide. Now, Prime Minister Modi, as you know, for 5 years tried very hard to make friends with Xi Jinping. He went to China, he called him to Ahmedabad. You remember that picture on a swing, both of them sitting, visiting Gandhi Ashram. And PM tried. Any other leader would have responded very positively. But in China, you have a machine, the CCP, the Chinese Communist Party. It has a head, but not very much of a heart. So I think the PM has now come to the conclusion that we cannot continue to pursue friendship. There are conflicts. We have to deal with them. And last year's Galwan events tightened the Indian response. Next slide, please. Okay. Because of the limited time that we have, I have only 4 slides and some visuals, but that's enough to cover the subject. And I'd like to leave time for questions. And may I suggest to the audience that from the start itself, if they have any questions, they can put it on the chat box. And Mr. Singhania will select some of the questions and put them to me. First, let's look at China and the world. Yeah, next slide. In the 20th century, late 20th century, early 21st, the US and European Union allowed China to be a member of the WTO in the fond hope that participation in trade and prosperity will move them gradually towards from a one-party dictatorship to democracy. This might have happened as early as 1971, as you know, Nixon and Kissinger went to Beijing. And that was because China wanted to confront Russia. At that time, the relationship was not good. So during the life of Mao, China was still an aggressive country, highly critical of India as a stooge of capitalist West. Deng Xiaoping was a breath of fresh air. He learned from Lee Kuan Yew, from Singapore, the model of those Asian economies. And he made three major reforms, which were excellent. And if China had continued with those reforms, they would not be a threat to the world and to us. He made the economic reform of the new economic zones, and also two reforms politically, that every president has a two-term restriction, then he has to give way to a new president. Xi Jinping has made himself president for life. It's a very dangerous kind of process. And the only way it can end is some kind of internal struggle, power struggle, factions and so on. That will be destabilizing both for China and the world. The other principle that Deng made was collective decision-making. The Communist Party now has delegated all decision-making to Xi Jinping. The personality cult, the delusions of grandeur, his thoughts are written into the constitution, the China dream. This is a bit reminiscent of Germany and Japan in the 1930s, in the last century. It led to the World War. They were eventually defeated, but it was a great cost. So China has given up the peace objective of Deng Xiaoping and is now looking for world hegemony, not only economic and technological, political, military, but cultural hegemony. They have a feeling that they're the chosen nation and they will not accept any equal. This is completely different. In the 80s, when I made several visits to China, Chinese intellectuals talked about our shared history. And they said in China, they believe that there are two heavens. China is the Eastern heaven and India is the Western heaven. That is the kind of relationship between us and Buddhism. Now China wants India to accept a subordinate status and never expect to be equal. And China has not a military dictatorship or a individualistic dictatorship like in Latin America. It is called social fascism. The party does good to the people on the economic side, but no political, press, democratic freedoms. China is defying the rule-based order. Just today, there is a news that the 2016 International Court decision on South China Sea, China regards it as an American ploy and has thrown it out completely out of contempt. Mr. Singhania, his uncle in the tire industry, many industries know in India, China's unfair trade practices, currency manipulation. In the US, they are accusing it of stealing technology, cyber spying and so on. And now they also have security, largest number of video cameras around the country to spy on its own people. Okay, next. So the world is also unhappy with China. And recently the G7 devoted time exclusively on China, and they have decided to take a tougher stand on this. And hopefully this should have some impact. But if there was a new chairman, Xi's two terms having over, there was a better chance. But now they will defend to the last drop. Okay, next. So China's growth, one of the ways it is visible is the carbon dioxide emission. And you will find that in 1970, it was quite close to the Indian level. And how they have come zooming up, so it is the biggest polluter in the world, heavy manufacture of coal. Well, Coal India is struggling to make 300 million plus. They have gone over a billion for a long time. Of course, they have now committed to going net zero by 2045. whether they will reach it or not. But even that may be late, the Paris Agreement and various commitments. So this is an index of China's use of energy, which is a proxy for the economic growth, particularly manufacturing growth. Compared to that, you can see all the other countries put together is that dotted black line. The US has steadied at around 5,000. Russia is much lower, 300 million people and falling population. Japan has also been switching to other forms of energy. And India has moved quite swiftly in the last few years to renewable energy. So China is almost half of the world's coal consumption and carbon dioxide emission. C2O is the biggest threat to climate, global warming. And we are told now by experts that this is a crucial decade. We have about 10 years to hold back, otherwise it will be too late for our children and grandchildren. That 3% limit cannot be kept and it will exceed that. Okay, next. Now, using its prosperity, I think that's a key. They have worked very hard. There are many good practices there, huge investments, inviting foreign investment, trading, and they built all that wealth. And now they are using it in various ways, not only in economic terms, but also politically. So the new Silk Road, Belt and Road Initiative, it is gradually getting a lot of countries into debt. And since they cannot pay the interest and repay the debt, gradually China may take over the key assets like ports, airports, factory towns of these countries. They'll continue to be reasonably economically comfortable, but China will have semi-colonized all these countries. Pakistan, some of the intellectuals in Pakistan realize and regret that it is already halfway towards a China colony. And the South China Sea, China brazenly claims it as its own. So it draws some lines and says it is ours. Even countries like Philippines, Vietnam, they're invading them, they're fighting with them, they're shooting their boats and threatening stances with their, they built up a huge navy as well and air force. They are into space. They have a plan by 2027, they would have matched and started to exceed the US military power. For everything, they have a prospective plan, 10, 15 years. And because the party, it's a very professional party. This we must acknowledge, that they are like a multinational corporation. They have career planning, succession planning, rotation. They're all qualified professionals, engineers, economists. And they've been through one of the 36 provinces administration. They've been to a few factories. They've done some foreign assignments. They're good at English. They're back, and therefore they have a very good cadre. And this is a very dedicated cadre, and there's only one politics there, that's the communist politics. So there is no internal rivalry. They're not canceling out each other. Okay, next slide. Challenges to India is what we want to concentrate on, and then I'll particularly come into the management challenges. So obvious challenge, which anybody, even common people in the rural areas can understand, territorial. They have last 70 years, very cannily, consistently refused to mark the border because it is convenient for them to go on claiming this piece, that piece. We'll see in another visual their huge demands on India. So one, it is a threat to the territorial integrity of India, especially in the northern areas, from Kashmir to Burma, that whole stretch. Anywhere there, they can make further claims. They're also creeping into Bhutan. So this is an insatiable appetite. They have enough territory, they have enough food for their people. But I think the fear that the party may be challenged. So they are bribing the Chinese people with stories of success, additional resources, and so on. To keep those territories and gain more, they are also a military threat to us. Very strong military, I think it all comes back to the Marxist idea of creating a strong economic base, creating a surplus. This they have done by basic care of the people, but no comforts. Their per capita income is still around $10,000. First the rural areas were squeezed, and then the industrial labor, minimum physical fitness and so on, but money diverted into military and political projects. So in 1980, the Indian Navy was advised to go for a blue ocean navy strategy. We were ahead of China in our total naval power, but now they have equaled, they're extending beyond us. We can match them, but we cannot afford to do so because we'll be taking away money from very essential social welfare and economic projects. They are a political threat. They will not allow India to come into the Security Council. They will not allow India to join the nuclear suppliers group. Wherever possible, they will put a spoke in the wheel. And of course, they are an economic challenge. And we are heavily dependent on them for many raw materials, exports. The balance of trade is hugely in favor of China. And we cannot continue to produce these imbalances. And as Mr. Singhania mentioned, the PM and the government had to think of something like Atmanirbhar Bharat. It is not against all countries, but to reduce our over-dependence on some of those countries which are not particularly friendly. I think we must hand it to the Chinese. They have also technologically advanced. We have stayed at the stage of collaboration agreements and renewal of those agreements. And the technology collaborator from abroad, Europe or America, will never give us the latest technology. So we have to have the Chinese kind of skill and talent and discipline to take one round of technology transfer and then meantime start our own. The Chinese, as I mentioned earlier, have a huge Chinese population in the US, on campuses and elsewhere, and they are all engaging in some kind of espionage and sending information. And now China has built also an indigenous R&D, quite strong. So they may not need these external inputs. And in some areas, they are going ahead. For example, they are leaders now in electric cars, in renewable power. They may be leaders in space, space mining, starting with Mars. So I think they are very ambitious, very determined, united as a nation. And this Communist Party, which is a technocratic party, is driving that whole. So this is an idea change. India, for the last 30 years, in all their internal discussions, India has not figured. Their comparison has been primarily with the US and the EU, equaling US has been there. So I think we are, from being an equal country in 1949, when they became independent, we become a relatively marginal country. It's partly our own fault. We have not looked at China carefully, underestimated them, especially the transition after Deng Xiaoping. And we have had our internal fights and so on, poor work culture. I lived in Calcutta during the period 67 to 72, when there was Garao, United Front, Left Front, various kinds of violent move, and capital flight from there. To reestablish that is very difficult. There are a few states in India, like Gujarat, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, who have done well. There is now an improvement in UP, but we have a long way to go. China has 36 provinces, all of which are competing in a healthy way and doing well. Yeah, next. Okay, here is a major territorial disputes. We know this generally. Just to remind ourselves, they still haven't recognized Arunachal Pradesh. You must have seen in the papers the last few years, they object to the president, prime minister, any minister visiting Arunachal Pradesh, as if it is not our territory, as if we are intruding into their territory. So I think if India grows weak at any time, they will, one scenario, some military scenario planning discusses is whether there can be a simultaneous attack from the West and the East, and India is caught in a pincer drive, China takes Arunachal and Pakistan takes the whole of Kashmir. That's an extreme, but we must prepare for those kind of possibilities on a military level. Now, Pakistan gave away Xinjiang to China, but we still have a claim on it. And with any other country, we would have had negotiations. But even in these Galwan negotiations, they are not serious. They are using the negotiation time to build silos for nuclear weapons, to build airports, more infrastructure. So I think we should not underestimate the military threat from China. Okay. Next, please. Next slide. All right. So here is a more specific, the whole border, 1570 kilometers in the western sector, 545 in the central. That's about the only relatively peaceful one. And we are overextended. If China were a democracy and a peaceful country, this border would be a very good resource for us for mutual trade, travel, tourism, and so on. But because of their militarization and overweening ambition to be a, they criticized for 40, 50 years US as a hegemon. Now, when they have grown, although per capita lower, but in terms of overall GDP, they will pass the US in 2-3 years. They are becoming dominant and wanting to rule the world. So we are overstretched on this long border, and it is going to be very difficult. They can open up a front anywhere. Okay, next. So I'm now coming to the challenges to Indian management, because I think the military will do what it can. Politically, government will negotiate. The foreign ministry will do its part. But the long-term battle between India and China is not political, it is not military, it is economic battle. The strength of the economy is the determining factor. And as we advance in our economic strength, there will be a more deterrent effect on China. We are now tempting them by our weakness. So in a way, an aggressive China has a positive side to it. Democracies have a tendency to be tamasic, go to sleep, obese, not fit, and indulge in various kinds of internal conflicts and so on. So an external enemy helps to unite the country. And we must use this period. I think in the long run, the answers have to come from Indian management. In the term management, I include the entrepreneurs, promoters, as well as the professionals. I have gone through this very silly debate in the 70s and 80s between owner and promotional professional. Some professionals were very, very arrogant enough to call promoters Lalajis. All that has changed significantly, as I knew it would. The third and fourth generation of family members are highly qualified, engineer, MBA in many cases. Mr. Harshvardhan Chingania himself is an example. So we now have two hybrid personalities, which is very good for India, and we should synergize the two of them together. One is the entrepreneurial professional who comes from the ownership family, and the other is the intrapreneurial professional who was a professional originally, but has learned from the entrepreneur some of the ideas of risk-taking, risk management, investment, thinking big projects, and the financial sense of bottom line, the obligations to external stakeholders, particularly shareholders, the independent shareholders. So I think from both sides, there is a movement and we can have a united team. So one huge thing to India is China's huge size and scale. I think those of you who have been to China or who have seen the size of the factories, it's amazing. One or two industries where we have good scale, one is the two-wheeler industry between Bajaj, Hero Honda, TVS. They've done well to protect the domestic market and also to export worldwide. They initially took technology, then they became more autonomous in technology. They spent more on R&D. The same thing is now happening in electric vehicles, retail, digitalization. Big groups like Tata and Reliance are making huge bets on renewable energy. I think we are now going for some mega projects. Only two or three groups in India have done it. Many more need to do this. So one question is whether in terms of strategy, a highly diversified group should have a very serious discussion and whether they should leave some businesses and concentrate on that area where they have the maximum competitive advantage and build a winning business there, which will manage risks inherent in. The Chinese productivity has been much higher than ours. We have known this for a long time. Some years ago, I gave the national annual lecture on productivity for the National Productivity Council. And I made a distinction between labor productivity, technology, capital productivity, and managerial leadership productivity. I think in India, we have been obsessed primarily with the labor productivity, which is about 10 to 12% of the total cost, and how to improve the capital output ratio, how to utilize the capital very effectively once it is in place. For example, I was directing the IMAS Advanced Management Program in Srinagar in 1980. As you know, we had that 4-week program at the Oberoi Palace Hotel in a beautiful setting. I gave a talk there. That year, India's savings rate had reached 24%, which is quite healthy. If we had a capital output ratio similar to South Korea, which is 3, our growth rate should have been already 8% per annum from 1980. That's what China did. They grew at 12, 14% per annum for a 20, 30 year period, and they built up this huge base. Now, even if they grow at 5, 6% on that large base, the net addition of wealth every year will be higher than if we grow at 8 to 10%. The economist some years ago said that unless India makes major reforms, the political and bureaucratic forces get out of the way, and business has much more autonomy and there's ease of business, India's natural rate of growth is only 7%. If it rises above 7%, there'll be inflation. Then it'll go back to squeezing inflation and reduce the rate. So we must break that barrier of a low-income country. China has to break the barrier of a middle-income country. They have to make political and economic reforms. So this productivity is an issue that we should seriously discuss and look at benchmarks from China. We also have to go for advanced technologies, more self-reliance, more expenditure on R&D, and scale, which will allow us to spend that money on R&D. Project management has been a particularly weak area of India. That is why the capital output ratio goes up. So I think we are getting better at revenue operations, ongoing plant capacity utilization, inventory management, dispatch, collection. That cycle is beginning to go well. But projects are always, majority of cases, we all know, time and cost overrun, post-commissioning glitches in the project. So one glaring example around 2008 was the way China held the Olympics. They gave the West a model. At that time, their Olympics was the best. The Brits were to do the next Olympics. They could not match China's scale, but they brought in some jazzy stuff like the Queen landing in a helicopter and so on. So they brought some fun into it. At the same time, we had the Asian Games, which was in a pathetic state for a long time. It was nearly a crisis. And as usual, we did the crisis management last minute and pulled off the game finally. As Mr. Singhania said, the Chinese are able to match any price. They will get a higher price when they can, and they will not be undersold by anybody. So there must be some overall judgment that they are making. The net profitability is okay. But within that, they have a high level of flexibility in their operations. Okay, next. I'm trying to allow some time for questions. Now, China's dominance is particularly strong in manufacturing. In 2018, 2 to 3 years ago, they had already a 28% share. And you can see India's very low share of 3%. It's a long way away. And we were about the same, and they have built up this huge manufacturing base, partly of their own capital, but they, Deng Xiaoping invited lots of foreign capital, gave them assurances, continuing operation. Now I think if China is taking a very tough stance, some of them may put future investment in other places. They cannot pull out. But China realizes this, and it's going for, it's an export-led growth. It is now going for domestic consumption-led growth. This transition will take some time. Even the US is left behind, 16.6. Mighty Japan in 1985, we thought the Japanese will become the world leaders. Japanese management practices will be the best in the world. The Chinese have come behind. If you take the EU together, they are a large economy. They are getting their act together. The European Union is getting stronger. I think the exit of Britain may be some kind of relief for them. They have some problems with East European pro-Russian countries. But bulk of Europe is now getting together, understanding the need for growth, need for more liberal policies than highly conservative German central bank policies, and also engaging in, along with the US, supporting the balancing of the hegemonic attempt of China, supported by Russia. So Putin and Xi are now making a proposition to the countries in Africa and the less developed Asian countries that do not go for democracy. It is not a good system. Go for communism. Go for a party dictatorship. We have the model. Look at us. We have outperformed them. This is a very dangerous kind of argument. These countries may fall for it. May not be good for them, but the more of the world going under the Chinese control is not good for us. So they are a threat to the democratic world, the idea now. Okay, the other countries are even smaller. I think we have to put EU together now, and that will be a force. Okay, next. Okay, now this is the most important slide. I am venturing to suggest to the FICCI, ASSOCHAM, CII, IMA, all the other professional associations of the country, that the economic leadership of this country cannot come from the government, politics, cannot come from the bureaucracy. I think starting from 91, the liberalization, the logical process is that we have to have a highly dynamic, competitive market economy. So the leadership is like a servant leadership from below, from behind, influence the thinking of the government. So one way for this would be that in every state, the leading businesses in that state put some money into a research, something like 0.5%, 1% of the revenue, and prepare some feasibility plans, identify the land, identify the technology, identify the markets, and say that they will go and invest, and what they need from the government in terms of water, land, electricity, the basic inputs. So the Chinese government asked each of their provinces to make these plans. First, the coastal areas made the plans, and then the plans gradually got into the middle of China, and now right up to Urumqi, they have in every state these kinds of large industrial estates. So I think the strategic thinking, Indian top managements have to think beyond their companies, beyond their groups, while not neglecting them. Set up the structure, have good governance, have senior management, delegate to them. Indeed, there's been a lot of delegation so far. But use their time and energy, partly, to look at what can they do to transform the Indian economic landscape and guide the government, guide the ministers, the bureaucrats, the state-level governments. I think some groups are doing this. More and more, we need to do it. Otherwise, India will continue to stagnate at around 5-6%, have a bad year. For example, the COVID pandemic has set us back by 2 years. Even if we recover, we don't have a strong third wave, it'll take 2 years for us to go back to 2019-20 GDP. So it is a huge blow. And I think we should also think in terms of, in those industries where too much splintering, too many players, the question of personal identity, egos, group names, if we can think in terms of some alliances that together and rename them creatively to preserve all identities, but we must get world scales. Otherwise, we will not be competitive in terms of cost. and how long can we sell on marginal cost and some losses. We cannot continue to rely on borrowing technology, buying technology. Massive cost-effective R&D is required. It is beginning to happen in some areas. IT can afford to do it. In fact, we've been saying for 20, 30 years that companies like Infosys, Wipro, TCS should move from software to software products, much more value-added products. Now, they have two huge problems. One is the R&D involved in the product. The second is global marketing of the product. But I think we have no escape in pharma, in many other industries. We have the foundation. We have to build on it. The new startups are bringing in some creative new technologies. Now, what large business can do is to help them scale up, take an interest in them, acquire them, support them in various ways. So look at an India partnership of businesses together face the world. So the government may look after the political security. The Indian military can look after the defense security, but the economic security, the business management, including owners and professionals, they are the trustees, in my view, of India's economic security. If business does not match up, does not come bring us to half of China's GDP soon enough, quickly, our security will be difficult. If we had no external aggression, we can continue to live a modest life with the economic freedom, lots of leisure, and some marginal people suffering quite seriously. But I think the neighborhood, we are particularly unlucky to have the world's two most difficult neighbors on the west and on the east. Therefore, we have no choice except to become strong, to take care of ourselves. So this is what I'd like to suggest, offer, paradigm change, leap in the thinking of Indian business, Indian professional managers, to think in terms of the state, the country, the region where they are operating now, and fill the gaps in the political discontinuity. For example, if the current NDA government is defeated in 2024, imagine for a moment, be another 5-10 years where the new government will may be busy dismantling some of the things that have been done rather than building on it. 2004 to 2014, we practically lost dynamic growth. That was a period where the momentum built up by Manmohan Singh and P.V. Rao, we should have taken us. That is a decade when we should have grown at 10-12% per annum. We were caught in various kinds of conflicts and corruption and so on. So I think there is a high discontinuity, unpredictability. Even if a majority is in power, the opposition is spending most of its time, and this is normal in democracies world over. So I think the political battle should go on. What has happened in the advanced countries is that in the economy, it is a competitive market, entrepreneurship, big businesses and corporations, industries that provide the leadership. And the government has to create the basic conditions, keep inflation under control. They won't go for massive stimulus year after year. In extreme case of 2008 financial crisis or pandemic, there will be big stimulus. But they'll be very soon worried about the inflationary effects. So I think similarly, we have reached that level where a political democracy is matched by a very strong competitive economy. And this is more in the hands of Indian entrepreneurs and managers than with bureaucrats and politicians. So I would like to conclude there and look forward to your questions. Harsh, if you have received already some in your chat box, I'll be happy to take them. Thank you very much for this opportunity to speak to you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Saab, for a very interesting analysis. And as always, like a management guru, it was all brought out very succinctly and on a few slides, the major points, and then you can talk around them, but very sharp and focused thoughts indeed. Thank you very much for that. We have many, many, many questions, but we have a limited amount of time. But And I will try, and I'm afraid I may not be able to take all the questions of everybody who posted it, so my apologies in advance. And I will not be able to pinpoint people, but what I will do is I'll try and sort of combine some of them.
If it's all right with you and the audience, I don't mind extending beyond 7, because we started a little bit late. 6:15.
So what we will do is we will extend 5-7 minutes beyond, I suppose, and you know, because other people also, and then it probably starts interfering with their evening times. We will take it on from there. One of the questions which and you've commented on that as well is around the issue of technology, as you put it out very well. So the question here is, how do we move from, as you know, looking and just taking technology and becoming technology owners? Now, you offered perhaps an answer in your talks, but would you like to elaborate on this fact? Because technology, not just adaptation, but further development has been one of the keys to the success we have seen from China.
Yeah, you see, for us, domestic R&D is even more critical than for China, because we don't have their culture and their skill and their brazenness in stealing technology. We simply cannot. We are rule-abiding global citizens. We are signatories to WTO, WIPO, Intellectual Property Organization, and therefore we are very decent citizens of the world, and the West appreciates that. There was a time when they would not even give technology at a high cost until we joined the BSE and made various reforms. So I think every company should make a careful assessment of its technological strengths and find a niche where they are most likely to be able to get the leadership, get patents, get proprietary technology. So we cannot do all R&D. But we must very carefully pick some areas. And I think once you start with one or two areas of R&D, the confidence builds up. For example, if you take the drug industry, there are companies which spend 8 to 10% of their R&D revenue on R&D. It's a huge gamble on proprietary drugs. And they say that if out of 10, 2 work out, that's good enough, a blockbuster. So I think R&D requires risk management, and if you can do risk assessment and carefully enter it, not blindly. So starting from small R&D and gradually scaling up is the answer. So we have to do it someday. We should have done it 40 years ago. For example, HMT. I was a consultant to HMT for a long time. We celebrated Dr. Patil and some of the earlier chairmen. But HMT went 26 times to the same technology provider for continuous updating of the technology. Now, we need not have done that once, twice, and then you get on with it. See, Hero and TVS have managed quite well, breaking their alliances. Honda left them, and they are managing on their own. So necessity is the mother of invention. So where we are generating surpluses, that's where productivity is important. Generate the internal surplus and start taking small risks and scale up. There can also be joint research of a number of companies together. This requires statesmanship, trustworthiness, and together have a project and all benefit from it. And it's against the world and not internally within India. So we can then get into a global market. Our world market share is still at around 1%. Our population is 14%. And we need to aim for something like 5% of the world trade exports. So I think technology is a key competitive factor in the long run. People can easily copy the other practices, materials management, cost management. People can follow.
Right. Thank you, sir. I think you made a very good point in terms of this whole joint research. And indeed, but that brings with it ingredients of trusting each other and having a common goal and purpose. I think that is the inherent part of what. One other question is around the fact that, you know, what about our Indian, we understand democracy is different from a sort of autocracy. However, Dr. Atreya, you've been a personal proponent of this. How do we bring in much greater discipline and accountability within our democracy? And I'm referring more in terms of, you know, what management can do, what we can do to make our own organizations mm-hmm. much more efficient through that. That is not the only means, but that is one mm-hmm. of the means.
Yeah, this is very necessary. I think the people have been teaching a lesson. There are only two parties in India. I think many people have. Mostly we have dynastic parties. And therefore, a dynastic party is against attracting new talent. So we have to have parties democratizing them. And our major opposition party is throwing away the opportunities repeatedly to professionalize and going back to the comfort of reliance on that one family. I think the only party in India, I'm not saying this as a political statement, as a realistic statement, the only party in India which can match the Communist Party of China is the BJP. 110 million members, all India organization, right down to the booth level, village level. We need one more party like this. If all the opposition can fuse together and professionalize and be a competitive person, so like the Labour and Conservative Party in the UK, or two, three parties in Germany. So I think they're learning the lessons, and the leadership is gradually moving to a younger generation. Even the Congress has produced people like Pilot, Madhurao Sindhya, Jyotiraditya Sindhya, Jitin Prasada. So there's the next generation coming up, which is more professional, more objective, more talented. They should be allowed to function. For example, in Bengal, although the TMC won, BJP's arguments are valid. It's going back to one person, nephew. I think we have to professionalize these parties. In industry, for example, I see the model has now settled down very well. The family members are being trained in the long run. They have to go through management, trained for governance, and professionals are coming up to the top management levels. So the same thing has to happen in the political parties.
Right. No, it's well put, and I think we need to put that together. One other aspect, if I may say, is, and you have been seeing this from different angles earlier, your involvement, you've been involved with various government bodies, policies, and also seen the management side of it, both public sector as well as private. How do we get, and I know there is no easy answer, but how do we get our entire ecosystem to work together? Because one of the things that business complains about is the fact that, you know, for example, our factor input costs are high. On labor productivity, which you talked about, we are hamstrung by certain regulations, laws, minimum wages and all that. Now, how do we bring this, because on management, I would believe that our management professionals are as good as anywhere else in the world. It doesn't mean that we don't have room for improvement, of course. But we are seeing people of Indian origin actually running the largest of US corporations, the most valuable US corporations. So there's nothing lacking there. Yeah. The same thing. We align the ecosystem, the political, the competitiveness, the efficiencies onto this.
You're right. It is a system. And the system has two parts. The system in government, which is unfortunately highly bureaucratic and slow. At least the government is now talking about the ease of doing business. It has metrics. It is comparing each year if there is some improvement. And also, instead of purely government of India, the states, at least some of the states are relatively better. I think in the last 3-4 years, it looks like the Chief Minister of UP has made a lot of changes, and UP has become a more attractive destination for investment. So center states, they have their role, and center has made the labor codes. And the labor codes need to be declared and implemented in industry. We'll always face, I think the union power in India has come down a great deal from what it was in 1980s. membership as well as the power has come down a great deal. The other thing is that within the company, managements can still create systems of good employee relations. Don't go for industrial relations. As far as possible, not allow an external leadership of the union. Take care of the employees. For example, some of the multinational companies in India, to hand it to them, Hindustan Unilever, ITC, they have built within India highly productive technology-driven, marketing-driven organizations. And some Indian groups like Mahindra, Reliance, they are moving in that direction. So I think we have to have central state government improvement, and also within the organization, better institution building and creating. The companies have to insulate themselves to some extent from a bad work culture of the environment.
Right. And Dr. Atreya, do you believe that while we have talked a lot about, we have talked about some of the Indian disadvantages, do you believe that the digital technology in the era offers us an opportunity to leapfrog over various legacy issues?
Yeah, it's a great technology. And I think during the COVID period, its use has increased vastly out of compulsion, working from home, working from anywhere, connectivity. People have learned new skills, even higher management, which is tech-savvy, which tech phobia has now learned to use it. We were good in coding and the lower end of the technology. Now we are getting the higher end of the technology. So one of the concepts is that like a profitable organization, humanistic organization, now the label to go for is a digital corporation. Every company now needs a 3-year plan by which it will become a completely digitized corporation and use the power of technology. That will help us to scale up also. I think we can also make products, the cloud, various kinds of IoT technologies. So I think it is now for people, government cannot do it. I think the telecom reform is one of the best things we did. If we had not opened up to the private players and corporatized BSNL, we would still be stuck with a huge inefficient 500,000 labor force, adding 1% connectivity every year. So I think it's a partnership, but in your own enlightened self-interest, in my talk, I'm expecting the top managements of Indian companies to seize the leadership without defying politicians and bureaucrats. Give them their space and run with the ball.
Yeah, I think that there is a very important message in what you say, and you brought that out in your presentation as well. We all know the limitations of the system, but there isn't much gain, if I may paraphrase what you are saying, in simply drawing comfort or resigning from blaming that we don't have this, we don't have that. We have to find our ways around it. And frankly, if we have to do things going beyond the borders of India, but bringing that to the Indian economy, you might as well do that.
Yes, we should be global now. This I've been saying since 2000. Global in procurement of technology, in raw materials, in equipment, in talent. We are sending out our talent, but we are reluctant to bring in the talent. And Wipro is now having a good chief executive. Infosys has a NRI chief executive. So I think we should be willing to get that kind of talent utilize the world market as a source as well as a destination.
Right. Dr. Atreya, I mean, I'm conscious of time while you are willing, but nonetheless, I'd like to come to one final question.
Okay.
Which is, what do you perceive as some of the challenges? This is a question which really came in our chat. What are the challenges perhaps that China faces in the near future or in the next few years?
Okay, there are some challenges. I did not mention them because we'll then take comfort from that and relax. That was my anxiety. One is that their population is aging, which is a serious problem. So they will have the classic Western problem of pensioners and the smaller, because of that one child policy, they were smaller younger generation, which will have to produce the wealth to take care of the seniors also. That's why they're now announcing a three child policy. What a change from one child policy to a three child. Millions of baby girls were killed during the one child policy. Now they want a three child, but the problem is they may offer incentives, but people don't want a three child family. People have got used to comfortable life as a childless couple, one child couple, and they may not be tempted. So I think the desire for parenting and bringing up children, that has gone down. Other is the problems of democracy, the way they are cracking down on DACMA, on Didi. This could affect the business confidence of the top companies in the country. And they may have difficulty producing newer billionaires like them. Within the Communist Party itself, there may be dissensions, groupism, some challenge to Xi's authority, and gradual political change. If they could go back to Deng Xiaoping's. Also, I think the excessive conflict may unite other countries around the world. So they could have restrictions on trade, on technology, access to markets, capital flight from China. I think this is Biden's intention, clearly. Biden and G7 together, they want to stop this misuse of access and freedom to be in the global market. I think the ASEAN countries may also at some point be firmer on the South China Sea. Recently, there was an interesting report in Philippines. The patrol boats, they changed the leadership from men to women. And they drew away some of the intruders from China and the other countries. And so I think people will be searching for ways in which to, and they'll be encouraged by the Western and Indian stance now. India is firmly in the Indo-Pacific camp. And even within India, there is no big debate. We have given up the old shibboleths of non-alignment, not being with anyone, particularly our anti-Americanism. We are realistic now, more pragmatic. So China will find a hostile global economic and military environment and internal problems. And at some point, they are worried also the population will start falling. They're worried that India will be the most populous country in the world. They are most worried about India. India is the only credible challenge to Chinese hegemony. The Western countries may have money and wealth, they don't have people. So India is the only country which can give them a challenge to global domination. If we get our economy act together, if every Indian becomes half as productive as the Chinese, we will be a powerful economy. That they're worried about. They want to stop this development process as much as possible. Now they are going into Afghanistan. Again, a pincer kind of operation.
So that is a very good and optimistic note to end on, that even if we can be half as productive, we will be a great economic power. And you have always believed in the Indian strength of our values, our capabilities. And it is time we realize that. And even on some of the things that you talked about, and in fact, in the chat box, if you had a chance to see, there were questions or observations around, you know, the possibility to some extent of balancing the Belt and Road Initiative with the Quad that India is now becoming a part of, and many other such global alliances which you have talked about, and saying that if things become too hard, others will eventually coalesce in some way or the other to sort of defend the turf, the global turf. But it's a great thought-provoking discussion we've had today. And again, my sincere apologies to all those whose questions I couldn't take because there were so many of them. And but I tried to combine a few and get this. Dr. Atreya, even if we were here all evening or all night, beyond your bedtime, I don't think the flow of questions would stop. So thank you very, very much once again.
Just like me, one last comment, summarizing comment. The Indian economic growth and economic power is now an orphan. And it needs a parent. Indian top management is the only potential parent of the economy. We must take charge and take it forward. And that's as high a faith I have in Indian entrepreneurs and management. Only they can take this country forward, not bureaucrats and politicians and generals.
That there couldn't be a better message to IMA.
IMA has a great role to play. For example, this national convention which is coming up, they've chosen a good topic, but if I had had a role in it, post-COVID growth is a short-term issue. It's a temporary issue. China is a decade issue, 100 years. It's long. That's what we should be discussing. So I think next year's convention could be on managing India to deal with China, cope with China, whatever, something like that.
So, Rekha, you already have, you don't have to spend time on thinking of a new topic for next year. You already have that. And thanks to Dr. And you should be, you should be picking on his brains a little bit more. And we do that. So, Rekha, over to you now.
Thank you, Dr. Athreya. I really don't need to say anything anymore because the comments say it all. If you look at the chat box, I think these are some of the most wonderful comments I've seen. And thank you for an excellent commentary on China. I think it was very, very useful for all of us. And as Mr. Singhania said, we look forward to involving you and getting your guidance on where on some of the IMA programs that we do. So thanks a lot for joining us. And thank you, everybody. And
thank you all very much.
We'll have Dr. Athreya with us once again.
Thank you, Dr. Sam.
Since there are a lot of questions, perhaps we can put your email on the chat. And if you can just put your email, so people can just email their questions to you.
Yes, certainly. Yeah, that's something I do. I have time now and I'll respond to those questions. And I'll benefit from some of the stimulating and difficult questions.
So may I request you to put your email ID, and if anyone whose question has not been answered can write to Dr. Athreya.
I have no intellectual property and I have no defense. Yeah. All right.
So thank you all.
May I
thank you. Azriya, thank you very much.
My thanks to all the audience, very senior people there that I see, limited numbers on the screen, but more than 200, 300 had come at some point. Thank you very much. All the best.
We also had about 400 on our social media channels. Okay. So we were close to about 1,000 people watching this.
All right. Okay. I'm so glad. It's an important message, has reached a lot of people. And even if there are about 20% below the age of 40 and they pick it up, that generation can take it forward.
Fantastic. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Yeah, I can't stop talking.